Hello everyone, my name is Serkan Ünlü and I am from Ankara, Turkey. In this video session, I will talk about basics of speckle tracking. Here are my disclosures. My presentation will cover the features of basic strain imaging and its application and interpretation of the results. Why do we need deformation imaging or speckle tracking? Actually, in cardiology and all other medical sciences and practices, we expect that imaging modalities would give us valuable information on diagnosis, response to treatment, or prognosis. Moreover, this information must be robust, reproducible, and quantitative. In daily practice, conventional echocardiography was highly subjective, and depending on the experience of sonographer, with also having high intra and inter-observer variability. The main goal of echocardiographic examination, in most cases, is to evaluate the function of the left ventricle. And ejection fraction and wall motion scoring have been used for this purpose. However, we know that there are pros and cons of each method. Ejection fraction can be calculated by all imaging modalities, and by Plain-Simpson method is the recommended for echocardiographic evaluation. We can say that ejection fraction is widely available, somehow reproducible, and related with diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment response. However, it is mainly affected by the experience and the skill of the sonographer with high variability, and it does not give information about regional function. In addition, we all know that ejection fraction is not directly showing the contractility. Wall motion scoring, which is an also widely used method for particularly evaluating the regional function, is subjective and highly operator dependent. Mainly, radial function is estimated by checking the myocardial shortening and thickening in wall motion scoring. And this causes limited estimation of the longitudinal and circumferential function. These mentioned conventional methods concentrate mainly on the radial function and they ignore longitudinal function, which in most cardiac pathologies is altered before changes occur in radial indices. Therefore, deformation imaging has been helping us to quantify left ventricular function and mostly has been used for many cardiac pathologies. Deformation imaging can provide us many parameters like velocity, strain, strain rate, and displacement. Tissue Doppler was the first method used for assessing deformation. However, in 2014, a novel methodology was introduced. This is called speckle tracking. It depends on following the bright marks, bright speckles on myocardium during the time course. With this method, all deformation parameters, but mainly strain, could be also calculated from 2D echo images. Strain could be in three directions. Among those, longitudinal strain is the mostly used one, as it is more robust and reproducible. But how do we measure strain with speckle tracking? Global longitudinal strain is the mostly used parameter with speckle tracking images, and global longitudinal strain is overall length change of myocardium during heart cycle. It can be calculated from endocardial, midwall, or epicardial contours. Speckle tracking echocardiography is the most widely used modality to measure strain. And global longitudinal strain or longitudinal strain should be measured precisely and appropriately since there are many sources of variability. Speckle tracking echocardiography can be performed on 2D or 3D images. It can provide global or regional strain measurements. There are softwares which requires manual corrections or it can be fully automatic. It does not need dedicated image acquisition like tissue Doppler. However, it has lower temporal resolution than the tissue Doppler imaging and it is affected by 2D image quality. It shows substantial differences among vendors and it's highly affected by the post-processing algorithms. To measure strain or GLS, there are several steps. First, a good quality image must be acquired. You should focus on left ventricle with good ECG trigger. Endocardial borders should be visible during systole and diastole. Second step is to set up event timing. Vendors offer several ways to do it, but the best way is to use Doppler traces and define exactly aortic valve closure time. Then region of interest can be created. Reference structures should be focused on. Endocardial, epicardial borders should not be exceeded. Trabeculations and papillary muscles should not be traced. Region of interest can be adjusted according to underlying myocardium. And at last, region of interest should be checked for the tracking quality. For obtaining an image with good quality, focus on the image geometry and avoid acquiring foreshortened images, as it is here. We know that endocardial strain is more affected by foreshorting than medial strain, and apical segments are more affected than basal ones. Some softwares are more affected by foreshortening than the others. Try to also obtain an image without noise, focused on left ventricle. Make sure that endocardial border is visible during heart cycle. And frame rate should be over 40 frames per second. Enough number of cycles should be acquired, and in case of arrhythmic patients, more cycles can be acquired, maybe more than 5. And you must pay attention to acquire beats with similar RR intervals. ECG should be checked if trigger points are placed correctly at the beginning of the heart, at the beginning and at the end of the heart cycle. For event timing, use Doppler traces to define the exact aortic valve closure time. It can be less important for GLS measurements, as many vendors represent the peak strain over the entire heart cycle, but still event timing matters. After defining event timing, you can start creating the region of interest by identifying the endocardial surface by manually placing appropriate number of markings. If it is a proper tracking, then approve for confirming that the region of motion, region of interest, motion is following the myocardial motion. Then select your choice for defining aortic valve closure timing. I strongly suggest use event timing, which you had with Doppler traces among these three options. I want to show some examples on the common mistakes while creating region of interest. Detection of the reference anatomical structures are really important. And here in the first image, region of interest is exceeding to the apical epicardium and it's wrong. On the middle one, tracing of anteroseptum is wrong and it should not exceed into LVOT. On the third image, you see an example of inappropriate tracking of the mitral annulus. Mitral annulus should be identified properly, and the region of interest should not exceed insertion of mitral valve leaflets. Correct tracing of endocardium and epicardial border is really important. Here in first two videos, you see different region of interest placed on the left ventricle. In the first one, it is inside the endocardium, and in the middle image, it extends to pericardium. And placing region of interest inside the endocardium will result in overestimation of strain values, and extended into pericardium will result in underestimation of strain values. And tracing endocardial borders of trabeculations should be avoided. Also, tracing papillary muscles should be avoided. You see them on the third image. Check carefully if the region of interest motion is following the myocardial motion. If there are badly tracked segments like this one, like this posterior basal segment here, it can be adjusted again, and you can correct it by adjusting, and you can obtain a proper tracking. After completing all the steps, the software provides strain traces from each apical view and the bullseye plot. Here you can see strain traces of each segment. Usually 18 segment model is used and a bullseye plot is given that you can easily document left ventricular, entire left ventricular deformation in a plot. The average GLS is also reported. The bullseye plot or strain traces can be changed to show any deformation parameter supported by the vendor. I would like to show some examples for interpretation of the results. Here you see the images of a patient with anterior myocardial infarction, and if we check the strain traces, you can see that segments in the anterior wall and anteroseptum have reduced absolute strain values, and you can also spot that GLS is reduced too. For segmental analysis, the pattern recognition is more important, as in segment level speckle tracking has low reproducibility. Here in the first image, the strain values of septum is reduced in a patient with asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. And on the second image, we see a zone with reduced strain in the apex in a patient with apical hypertrophy. Here you see a case of amyloidosis with apical sparing, since deposits mainly located in the basal segments. To conclude, speckle tracking provides incremental diagnostic and prognostic information. Appropriate interpretation of measurements need experience. Images with distorted geometry should not be used. A proper definition of region of interest is needed for the high quality measurements. Event timing matters. Automated functions can be used but still need to be corrected manually. Vendors show significant differences, and software upgrades can result in significant changes in measurements. Thank you very much.